5, 4, 3.
Good evening and afternoon, everyone. My name is Josh Toso. Thanks again for tuning in and welcome back to the Starboard Portal. We have a very special panel presentation for you today. Mighty Mary's America's Cup campaign had a profound impact and influence on women's sailing and the sport of sailing as a whole. This evening, we take a little walk down memory lane with team members Don Riley and Katie Pettibone, and we'll also learn a little bit about the impact the team had on the sailing careers of Molly Vandemoer and Melanie Roberts. This rock star panel is moderated today by Elizabeth Kratzig as she helps us dive into the state of women's sailing and in the industry, what we have learned, where we are now, and what the future holds. Thank you, Don, Katie, Molly, Melanie, and Elizabeth for joining us today. And thank you to all of our viewers who are tuning in and those of you who are going to watch this presentation on playback at some point later. Please feel free to put any questions that you have in the chat feature on the right-hand side of your screen. And Elizabeth will ask the panel towards the end of the presentation if she has some time. And if you enjoyed today's session or any of the other sessions we put on, please support our efforts to build a community of active engaged sailors through the Starboard Portal by purchasing or renewing a U.S. Sailing membership. We have a lot of great content coming up in the schedule. And thanks to U.S. Sailing members, we're able to adapt and evolve to better serve sailors with content like this. So please visit us at mem.ussailing.org to join or renew your U.S. Sailing membership today. Without further ado, I'd like to hand it over to Elizabeth. Rock on, ladies.
Thank you, Josh. I'm really honored to be able to interview such an amazing group of women. And I want to give you a quick bio of each of them. And all of them have done extraordinary things in sailing and in their careers. So we'll start with Don Riley. And Don, as the CEO and captain of America True, Don Riley was the first woman to manage an America's Cup sailing team. She raced on 4 America's Cups and 2 Whitbread, now the Ocean Race teams. In her first Whitbread in 1989-90, she sailed as watch captain, diver, and engineer. And you could see more about this race in the newly released documentary Maiden, which is great if you haven't seen it. Don is a former president of the Women's Sports Foundation and has served on the board of U.S. Sailing. Finally, Don was one of Sports Illustrated top 100 greatest female athletes of the 20th century. Originally from Southeast Michigan, Riley has been in Oyster Bay, New York at Oak Cliff Sailing since its inception in 2010, and she currently serves as Oak Cliff's executive director.
And I'm still at work.
Thank you, Don. The next person that was also on the Mighty Mary was Katie Pettibone. Katie was the youngest member of the first All-American Women's Cup team in 1995. And Katie went on to become a renowned world-class competitive sailor and leader. She has been a skipper, a yacht captain, and a coach in a variety of races around the world. She's a veteran of 3 America's Cup teams, 2 around the world races, as well as the famed Sydney Hobart and Worrell 1000 Extreme Catamaran races. From 2014 to 2016, Katie was on the U.S. sailing team in the NACRA 17 class. Katie, also from the Midwest like Don, she grew up sailing on the Great Lakes with her family. And in addition to excelling in the professional sailing world, Katie holds a law degree and is a very successful lobbyist in California. So, thank you, Katie.
Good to be here. Thank you.
Okay. Molly Vandemoer, a native of California, Molly began sailing in her youth in San Diego. Molly was a high school national champion in 1996. At the University of Hawaii, Molly was named to the All-American sailing team 3 years and won the college national championships in 2001. She went on to become a member of the U.S. sailing team for over 12 years, from 2003 to 2015. And she competed in the 2012 Olympic Games. Molly holds 2 world championship titles, one in the snipe women's class and the other in the women's match racing discipline. Today, Molly is the current president and clinic director for the California International Sailing Association, as well as the director at the Peninsula Youth Sailing Foundation, which is a position she has held for 6 years. So thank you, Molly.
Thanks for having me.
And last but not least, Melanie Roberts. And Melanie grew up in San Diego, learned to sail in the San Diego Youth Junior Program. She was America Cube's self-professed number one fan. As a child, Melanie collected America Cube's team members' autographs and kept a scrapbook of newspaper and magazine clippings of the Mighty Mary team. Inspired by America Cubed, Melanie excelled in high school sailing, winning the 2003 youth championships in the double-handed division, the high school national championships, and the team racing national championships. At the University of Southern California, Melanie was named twice to the All-American sailing team. After college, Melanie worked for the 34th America's Cup as race committee coordinator and the Red Bull Youth AC manager. She also worked for the 35th America's Cup. And currently, Melanie leads the race management team for SailGP. So we have an incredible group of women here. And just to kind of kick it off, we're going to watch a short video of some of the events that happened. I'm gonna see if I can share my screen here. Screen. Here we go.
When they used to say, left behind every great man, there had to be a great woman. But all in these times have changed. I know that it's no longer true. So we're coming out of the kitchen, cause there's something we forgot to say to you.
Make it stop.
Make it stop. Okay. Sorry about that. Okay. So, well, we've got a little video, a little music to set us off on the right track here. And that was a really great video. Some of that footage was spectacular. So I'm going to start off with Dawn, because Dawn, you really paved the way for women in professional sailing. And I'd like to know, how did you decide to pursue sailing professionally?
It was kind of an accident. When I was 13, we were sailing with our family for a year's cruise. And that's the first time I knew that there was people that actually got paid to go sailing. So I think as teenagers are, you just kind of try it out. I'm going to be a professional sailor. I'm going to sail the America's Cup. I'm going to race around the world. And then when somebody said I couldn't, I was like, oh yeah, F you, watch this. So that's really essentially how it all started. And I literally, though, in the beginning was working on boats. I was the youngest and probably the only person that didn't have a real job, as we like to call them. And I worked on a boat and was only doing it to put myself through college. I didn't really quite know that it was going to last 40 some years. And yes, I am the oldest on this group. I'm fully aware.
So what did you face any barriers sort of in your entry into professional sailing? And what was your first time when you sort of stepped back and said, wow, I'm a professional sailor?
I don't think you ever step back and say I've made it. Even a couple of years ago, I was supposed to go sail in the Voile in St. Bart's, and I got the flick. And there's no question in my mind, it was because, you know, actually the beginning of it was, we don't have women on board the boat. I'm like, really? In 2019, we don't do that. So you never really sit back. But I think I just woke up one day and realized that I'd graduated from college, put myself through, and was being a professional. And, you know, honestly, probably in between after the first round the world race, which obviously everybody's seen in Maiden, but that was the first time, you know, I was on television, met Gary Jobson, and that was what gave me the chutzpah to go out and try out for the America's Cup. And that was somewhere in there when I'm dealing with contracts and media and sponsors, I was like, oh, you know, and you saw a little bit of that with the video. You know, the women's team got a lot of publicity, but before that I was in like People magazine. It was, of course, a romantic photo shoot of the guy I was dating and myself, because that was People magazine. So that's when you know, other people start telling you you're a professional, and you're like, oh, I guess I am.
So you were the first woman to have a physically active role in the America's Cup, and you were on the winning America Cube team in 1992. And I'm wondering, did you influence at all Bill Koch's decision to pursue the all-female team in 95? You there, Don?
I'm having trouble hearing here right now.
I'll repeat the question. Basically, you were on the winning America's Cup team in 1992 with America Cubed. And you were one of the, you know, the first kind of woman, physically active woman on an America's Cup team. And I'm wondering if you were if you influenced Bill Koch at all to have an all-female team in 1995.
Oh, yeah, for sure. The first thing is that I think what happened was he's spent a lot of money and a lot of time doing the 92 team and then started looking around. I think literally he didn't want to do another campaign because, as I say, when I'm doing corporate speaking, the hardest thing to do is to win the America's Cup. But the hardest thing to do is to win it the second time. And the only way to do that is by putting up, and that's where you can start to talk about diversity and having women and different racial backgrounds in the sport and in your team and in your business, because you need a different perspective. He knew it was going to be extra hard to try to do something that we'd done to perfection at that point. And they were looking as another option. And I honestly don't know who was the person who said, you should do an all women's team. I do know that when they first said to do an all women's team to me, I thought they were crazy. Same thing is with Maiden. I'm like, oh dear God, let's just sail mixed.
Okay. And why did you think it was crazy to have an all women's team? Okay. Well, we might've lost Dawn there for a minute. So I'm going to move on to Katie. Katie, as the youngest member of the America Cube team, how did you come to be on the team, and how did you hear about it? What impact did that team have on you?
So I was the youngest. I was actually in college. I'd read about the tryouts. I think in that video you showed, there was a quick blurb of that. But I saw it and I applied. I didn't have any of the big championships or Olympic medals or things like that. So I was just a hardworking sailor from the Midwest, living in Miami, going to school down there. And I just spent my time sailing on as many boats as I could with as many good people as I could, learning as much as I could. So I tried out, and I remember my parents saying, oh, you're crazy, you'll never make it. But I always live my life on, you got to try, because if you don't try, you'll never know. And then it turned out there were three tryouts. And the first two tryouts in my memory and what I view it were the kind of more the who's who have the resumes to be there appropriately. So, and then there was a third batch of the people like me that were like, give them a go. And so, you know, I just buckled down and ended up making the team. And I'll never forget, I was home in port here in Michigan when I got the call from Kimo Worthington saying, so what do you think about coming to San Diego sailing? And I was like, oh my gosh, so excited. And I knew it was going to change my life, and it sure did.
And how, I mean, obviously this changed your life in so many ways, but immediately kind of after the cup, did you know, you know, you were going to be going in this professional sailing direction or?
Well, immediately after the cup, I had promised my parents I would go back and finish college. And so,
you were that young.
So I went back to school and I finished college. Now, there might have been a few midterms that I missed because I was off sailing in Japan or France or something. But, you know, I finished, I got my degree. And then when I was there, you know, the next offer to do an event and start sailing came along. And so I didn't really know what would happen. But, you know, I was just going to pursue what I could and do what I could. And there was just a lot of great racing around the world. And so, yeah, I just pursued it. And always knew that I could go back to school if I needed to. And you know, at least I had an undergraduate degree in marine biology.
It's always good to have a degree. Now you have two. So what, I guess for Katie and Don, what did it mean for you to be on this, the Mighty Mary program? I mean, what did it, how did you feel about being on the first Women's America's Cup team? What are some of the stories that you can tell us about the maybe perceptions that other people had, barriers you had to overcome, anything like that?
Let me just start off with that time I was actually being courted by another team that was going to give me a guaranteed A team position and a decent paycheck. And I chose to go with the women's team, which is so unlike me because I'm usually pretty cutthroat. But I knew that it was going to be pretty instrumental and important. And so I was doing it to make a difference and change society. And I think for the people that are younger, they won't remember how it was at that time. Society was different. And we were able to add in the Olympics in 96. And there was a women's baseball team called the Silver Bullets that, and the League of Their Own, I think, came out about then. So there was a whole big shift in society that really helped snowball so that the effect of the women's team wasn't just on sailing. It was outside of the sport and society in general and, you know, smashing glass ceilings and all of that.
Yeah. And for me, I all the racing I did was club level. And then, you know, the Grand Prix events that are, I grew up racing on the lakes. And so, you know, that was kind of around there and I sailed on mixed teams. I always was sailing with men and women. And in fact, one of the reasons I like sailing was because I could sail with both genders and people of a variety of ages and experiences. And so it was incredibly rewarding, both from a social and a competitive viewpoint. So when we did 95, one, having a women's team for this amazing race, I mean, I remember my parents going to Newport to see the boats, it was extraordinary. But in my mind, it was always going to be about trying to win. Right? It was always going to be about winning. So when we got on the boat and we ended up doing well and we were able to beat Dennis and we were in the fight, you know, mixing it up and people were blown away. I guess I was too young to realize what a thick glass ceiling that had been there before. You know, Dawn's from my area in Michigan. And so she'd already cracked that ceiling wide open. And so I didn't realize how big it still was in other places. So it wasn't until like at the end did I really understand the greater impact about it.
Well, it sounds like both you and Don have a, you know, the mentality, kind of grew up with the mentality that you can do anything that you want and really didn't, you know, when you were approached with somebody that said there's a glass ceiling, you said that doesn't exist. And Katie, you never really thought about it. And I think I've been pretty similar in my life. I always grew up, you know, thinking I could do anything as well or better than a boy.
Let me just clarify. I don't think it was that you can do anything you want. It was just, if you want to do something, you better do it yourself. I think that's a little bit more Midwest. Like you could fail, but if you don't want to fail, that's up to you. There's no real safety net here.
Okay. So you have to, both you guys gave it your all and, you know, and at the end of the day, we're successful. And do you think that, I guess, realizing the historical significance of being on, you know, did you realize when you were on this team? I mean, Donnie mentioned that you went on it sort of to help make a statement of political, and Katie maybe a bit more naive being younger, but after it was over, did you realize what sort of influence you had on, you know, females in the sport of sailing?
Yeah, but then we went immediately into the America True, which was co-ed. And honestly, I went into some of the management at America Cubed about, I don't know, 3 weeks before the end, a month before the end. And I said, okay, let's do this again. So, you know, I was the only female. I didn't think that that was, I thought we'd already made the point. Then, you know, we have to do this all the women's team to prove that it's not, you know, it's not a one-off, that there's more than one female, one token. Right. So let's do a mixed team. This is what we're going for. And I didn't get very much support from the business side of it. So I, sister's doing it for yourself. That's where I put the entry fee of the America's Cup on my Visa card, or half of it. And then we did America True, which Katie was our number one trimmer. And it was day by day by day by day making changes in that campaign. And just trying, all we tried to do, the only thing that was absolute is that I insisted that we treat every person as gender blind as possible, which of course is completely impossible when you know everybody. But so the only way to do that was by asking, okay, you don't like this thing that that person's asking for. If it was a man, would you still be upset? No. Okay, hire that person, right? So it was just an active conversation.
That's a good way to do that. And I guess moving on to Melanie, you know, as sort of the self-proclaimed number one fan, according to this article in the Baltimore newspaper.
Actually, I have a question. Melanie, do you remember that article?
Yes, I have a hard copy.
Okay, because Josh is talking about this article. I'm like, what is he talking about? But there we go.
Well, it was a great article. But you were obviously following the team very closely, you know, the whole entire time. What sort of impact did that have? You know, how did that influence kind of what you, you know, your future choices in sailing? And what did that mean to you watching this team?
Yeah, I was pretty young at the time, but I do remember a lot of this pretty well. You know, the America's Cup was such a big deal when it was in San Diego, and it was in the newspaper every day, and I literally clicked every article and put it in a scrapbook, and in particular became a huge fan of the women's team and followed them very closely. And yeah, it did have an impact on my sailing, because I thought, wow, that's cool. I want to do that. I want to be on a women's team. And that kept me in sailing and wanting to be involved in sailing. And, you know, this women's team's at the top of the sport in the America's Cup. And it was really inspiring. And what was even more inspiring was they were an amazing group. Like, they wrote back when I wrote letters, and they never said no when I asked for an autograph. And I'm sure I was a huge pest, and I know I asked to be the 17th crew a few times, and they politely gave me spectator boat tickets instead. But yeah, they were always nice, and I think that did influence my sailing and kept me in the sport and led me to where I am now.
What about Molly? You were a little bit older, because Melanie, how old were you during the America's Cup?
I was 9.
You were 9. Okay, so and Molly, you were a little older in high school, I believe. So what did you think of it? Was it this the same sort of awe-inspiring? Were you after everybody's autographs and...
So I was actually a little bit more shy, a little bit more held back, I guess reserved, but I was pretty intimidated by the group as a whole. I thought, oh my gosh, like, look what these ladies are doing and look what they're going up against. There was, so not in the 95 timeframe, but you know, the last iteration before that, I remember being younger and at a PR yacht club event with my parents and, you know, a bunch of juniors and kids and adults were there. And I watched, you know, some kind of angry older guy throw a drink on one of the sailors and that was about to go up on one of the ladies that was about to go up onto the stage for something. And to watch that interaction as a kid, which I was probably about Melanie's age at that time, I was shocked. I stood back and I was like, oh my gosh. And to see, you know, basically everybody said, oh, this guy's a jerk, you know, get him out of here. And all of the sailors just went on like, hey, we got this. It's all good. Brushed it off, kept going. And I think that etched in my mind. I was like, okay, these people are badasses. Like, wow. You know, they're going up against this, you know, stigma that it, thinking, what is this all about? You know, why can't, you know, women can't do this and that type of thing. I remember going home, talking to my parents and, you know, my mom being flustered and upset by it. My dad just calmly, you know, hey, Molly, you know, change is hard. It's awesome that they're doing this. There's no reason they shouldn't be. if you wanted to do it, you could do it too. And I remember going, ooh, okay, you know? And so then when the next iteration came and it was a whole team filled with women, I was like, wow, these people are awesome. And I was very kind of humbled and taken back, and I just kind of wanted to watch it and, you know, like see it all happen. And it was very, it definitely pushed me forward to say like, okay, you can do this. You know, kind of like what my dad told me, you know, a couple years prior, it was like, if you want to do it, put your head down, go to work. You're just as good as the person next to you. Doesn't matter, you know, girl, guy, you know, one arm, you know, no leg, doesn't matter. Just keep going. If you want to do it, do it. So.
So who were the biggest mentors, you know, for each of you in sailing? I guess was it a male or a female, or, you know, what kind of helped when things got tough? What helped, you know, you keep going?
Mine were bad influences, because there were no women, and I was from Detroit, and it is the Great Lakes. So I don't know how the heck I ended up being okay and now influencing the next generation at Oak Cliff. But it's okay. It's okay.
So there's not one person that stands out in your mind of, you know, or anything that, or maybe a situation that you were, you know, you got through that.
No, there's lots of situations, but I don't think anybody, but maybe Katie knows, Tim Woodhouse was probably my biggest mentor. But you know, he's the first person that organized for me being flown to a regatta to trim a sail when I was like 15, 16. So that was technically when I was pro all of a sudden, because I got paid and flown out to Manhasset Bay, which is just down the road from Oak Cliff right now.
I think for me, at least, you know, when I was much younger, it was more the crowd of the racers around the club. And when they would ask me to sail with them, I remember thinking like, that's pretty cool. Like, really, they want me to sail with them? I'm a pretty, you know, confident, headstrong person now, but as a kid, I would definitely sit back and just wait and look and take it all in. And it was really cool to see like the, you know, San Diego Yacht Club has a fair amount of like rock star sailors that are cruising around in the parking lot. And they are all like humble people and were very inviting to say like, hey, come and sail with me. So it's a pretty long list actually of like, it's not this one person or that one person. It was more kind of a collective deal that it didn't matter who it was. And they just said, hey, you know, you want to come sailing? There's a spot. Or, hey, I want to look at this sail and take some pictures. Can you drive the boat while I'm going to take pictures of the sail? You know, that kind of thing. That probably made the biggest impact on me continuing to sail.
Yeah, I think similarly, I think back to the early days, and you know, a lot of the sailmakers that I was able to sail with out of the Detroit area, you know, the Case DeLange, Wally Cross, other folks, and then people who gave me a shot to sail. I mean, what's interesting is when I was in high school, I was sailing on a J35 and I did all the races. I showed up for all the practices during the week, did all the work. And then when it came to Mackinac, they said, we don't take women. And so I was like, well, screw you. A, I'm not sailing with you again. And B, I went and got on a competitor boat, and then we beat them and won the Mackinac that year. And so, you know, you just take those things and you move on and say, I know where I'm going to put my energy, and I'm going to sail with the people that value me. And, you know, in those days, also sailing with older, saltier people, Dawn, you know what I'm talking about in Detroit, you also learn to grow a thick skin. And that, I think that's also really needed, because when you're sailing with people of all cultures and backgrounds and ages, you can't take things personally. And so that's also, you know, something that I took from my mentors.
And one follow-up question, you know, you just mentioned sailing with people of all different backgrounds and ages, and you've done some really interesting sailing around the world, particularly in Oman. And I guess, how did the Oman sailing that you did with the women over there, how do you think you influenced that, or, you know, what would you take away from that experience?
Well, you know, it's interesting because I think all the experiences that we have from kids at our yacht clubs to sailing on big teams, even America Cubed, I actually remember one of the crystallization light bulb moments that we had is when we were working with Don, I don't remember the which coach this was, but he was talking, we ended up doing Myers-Briggs and communication, and it really actually sunk in that when you talk to somebody a certain way, even though you think you're saying X, that depending on who they are and what their life experience is, they actually receive it in a different way. Mm-hmm. And so it really taught me at a young age to start using different ways to communicate, because even though I might be thinking I'm clear, maybe somebody's receiving it in a way that's not delivering a useful message. And we, of course, had Shelley Beatty, the siren. She was deaf. And so on the Mighty Mary, we had to learn to use hand signals because she couldn't hear. So that was also, you know, another way to just open your horizons about communicating with people. And then, of course, moving on into the around the world races, the Whitbreads and the Volvo, sailing a multinational team with people from France to Sweden to Australian Kiwi. You know, you end up really, we all have very colloquial ways of communicating, and you just really start to understand that the world is bigger than what we often experience. And then, of course, that really came to help when I was asked to go over to the Persian Gulf to help with Oman Sail and help train and coach these young Omani women to compete against boys, which was extraordinary. I mean, one of the most worthwhile things I've done. We went back a couple of times, I think it was three different iterations. And, you know, seeing these girls who initially the boys, the Omani boys didn't think they could do it. It was curious because they always thought Western women could do it, but they really didn't think that the Omani girls were tough enough. And then to see that respect and the camaraderie grow between those two. And then by the end of the event, when they were doing, you know, the hand karate on the docks with each other, it was extraordinary. And that program has continued and grown, and girls are still doing stuff. And I think it's just such an exciting, eye-opening thing of what sport and certainly sailing can do for the world.
I think that Oman Sail program is one of the coolest things that I remember reading about in terms of like mentoring future women, and particularly in an area that is not known for being friendly to females. So Melanie, I kind of skipped over you. So what is any person that you feel like you really influenced your sailing or?
Yeah, I'm going to get in trouble here because there are so many fantastic people that influenced my sailing, and inevitably I will miss out on some. So I'll just maybe tell you about the first one. And that was JJ Fetter in 1992, after she had won the bronze medal. I wrote her a letter and she wrote me back. And then of course she was on Mighty Mary. And then it came full circle when she had a daughter that I ended up coaching at San Diego Yacht Club. And yeah.
It's, I think it's interesting to see, you know, how many of you have one particular mentor or multiple mentors, whether it's male or female. Do you think that, I guess, Dawn and Katie, I mean, Mighty Mary certainly drove, you know, the visibility of women in sailing. And what do you think were the main kind of trickle down effects of that? Not just in sailing, but also just in terms of women in sports?
So let me just go real quick. The first one is it legitimized the fact that women can sail at every beer can regatta everywhere. I remember distinctly doing a speech before the women's team and after the women's team. And it was often that women that were, you know, 40, whatever, would come and say, I used to sail, but then I got divorced. And I knew we had to change something the first time. I think I might've been at North Star Sail Club. Somebody came up, she goes, yeah, I got divorced and I was ready for this. And she goes, I divorced his ass and I kept the boat. I was like, yes, we have made some change. So that type of stuff empowers people to go out in society and to be more powerful and more vocal. And it's not just about the sport of sailing.
Katie?
Yeah, it's interesting. So like I mentioned, I went back to college, but I kept sailing, and we had a kind of a number of women from A Cubed that we kept doing events. And Dawn was part of one of the events we did immediately after we did the Tour de France on the Voile. And then during the year, I remember going to Japan and doing Nippon Cup. And I remember going to Italy and doing an event. And in those places, what was interesting is these international teams of very good sailors of men were just gobsmacked. It was almost like we were, you know, a traveling zoo show. But then when we beat them, they were like, whoa, they really have the goods. Like, they were really impressed. So they knew about it. And then, you know, the continuing to do it, we showed them it was real. And so I think the trickle down is just that, you know, people are doing more. I mean, I see more women. I just see it happening everywhere. And so, you know, from when I was in high school at a local club, I you know, now there's just so much more. And, you know, it's hard for me to know where it, you know, trickled down to, because there's just been so many great teams of women, and certainly female Olympic medalists, and you know, I just think it's kind of been a collective thing. And again, for me, it's hard because, you know, Dawn broke the ceiling, so I already was looking up, and so it's, you know, you just continue to try to do more and more and sail with people. So, and then there's just inevitably trickle down for everybody.
So what, I'm going to move on to Molly a little bit. You know, having competed in the Olympics in a all-female, you know, class, do you believe that, I mean, they're now, the Olympics are going to have a gender equity. There's going to be the same number of male and females at the next games. That's obviously promoted and more women sailing, but do you see that that has helped women kind of after the Olympics? Do you see that it's promoting more women into sort of professional sailing or leadership roles as well? And do you believe in having separate events, men and women?
I think it kind of similar answer to the other ladies, that it's, I can't pinpoint it and say, you know, hey, this is exactly what's the effect of this. But I will say that I think it's just becoming more commonplace that you see women in leadership roles, you see women, you know, coaching the elite teams, being an elite team, kind of across the board. It's become basically normalized, right? To have women in powerful positions that maybe before, kind of like, you know, you get divorced and you leave the boat, like Dawn said, it's, you know, oh, it's not, you know, so-and-so that's the Commodore, that, you know, their family's been involved forever. It's people coming into the sport from, you know, the middle of no water. And it's also women that have no tie to a family or to a man that's going to bring it to them. So I don't know if it's, well, now that we have 50-50 in the Olympics, that's going to, you know, what's going to happen or what's happening today because of that. But I don't think, if anything, it's helping, right? It's going to help because it's becoming normal. With the question of, hey, do you think that...
No, I say, I was just curious, though, how do you think of, you know, you feel about having separate events? I mean...
Right, I was just going to, yeah, talk on that.
She was like, you know, I wanted to race with the guys. And in the end of the day, Mighty Mary, you know, put a man on their team. And so I guess...
Right. The Olympics are a gender sport when you look at all other, you know, sports. I think that when I go to a world championship that is mixed, you know, there's a ton of sailing that's mixed. I love racing mixed. I think there's no reason that it has to be segregated. I think having it segregated only helps increase the numbers of people that come into the sport, if that makes sense. It's sort of like you need the segregated part, you know, hey, here's an all girls event that's going to happen to bring in the people that aren't maybe as comfortable or a little more shy or a little more reserved, because it's a bigger comfort zone than it would be separate. But I also think there's probably sailors out there that are like, I would never go if my brother wasn't there or my best friend that happens to be a guy. So I think it basically just gives more women, more girls out there, an opportunity to have an entry into the sport.
So Melanie, as a race administrator, you know, and having played such a big role in a couple of the America's Cups and now SailGP, do you find yourself, are there many women in kind of leadership roles in race admin? Are you one of the only ones? Are there any, you know, kind of differences or that you're treated, anything like that?
Not particularly. In the event world, there are tons of roles for women, not necessarily all in race management, because you only need a couple of those people per event. But, you know, if you look at an event, you know, there's marketing, hospitality, you know, you name it, there's all sorts of departments. So SailGP and all the America's Cups I've worked for, I'd say, you know, the staffing was about 50-50. When it comes to race management, yeah, I would say it's still dominated, but a lot of the membership at St. Francis that I got to connect with were actually really incredible women that were great race officers and other race officials. So there's definitely opportunity there.
So, I mean, looking kind of, just having done a little bit of a study this winter on female, the number of females in sailing, it's still very low compared to the number of males, the percentage, not just in, as sailors, but also race officers, judges, officials. So what do you guys think, I'll start with Donnie, what can we do going forward? How come it, more hasn't happened since the Mighty Mary program, you know?
Right. Well, the first thing is we're always, I'm always impatient to try to get the ship done, right? But then when we have conversations like this, it reminds me that in 1992, if the secretarial, that's how old I am, secretarial staff wasn't on site and retail, I would have been the only female on site out of a team of like 240. So now hearing Melanie talk about having, even in those jobs that are more traditionally women and the PR and the marketing, logistics and the organization and the media, in 1992, those were still all men because they figured that there were zero women that could talk about sponsorship in the sport of sailing. So we have made a significant amount of progress. If you jump to total equality and equity, you have to have women decision makers so that it becomes natural. It will not be natural for a guy who's only dealt with guys on a race committee, for instance, to put a female on. He might do it and it might be like, "Ooh, look, I found a girl and she can take time." You know, it's insane and ridiculous. So you need to have the women in the leadership so that they make it normal, so that then another generation from now, unfortunately, there's men that are in charge that it's natural for them to have women. But at this point, we're not quite there yet.
Katie, what do you have anything to say about that?
Why? No, I absolutely agree with Dawn on the management side and leadership. I mean, whether it's corporate or politics or sport, you know, it's a true thing that if you see somebody in a position, then you can think that you can do it and it becomes normal. And so it just has to be done. And I do see, I mean, Dawn taking the bull by the horns and having the team in 2000 America's Cup. I mean, that was extraordinary because it was a very deliberate attempt to say, we're going to have mixed and we're going to make this happen and no one's going to do it for us. And, you know, talking to people on the team like Hal and Al, who are legendary in the America's Cup world. And you know, those guys loved the team. We're still super close today. And it was a team of people who wanted to be there for, I don't want to say there is such thing as a wrong reason, but they were there because their heart was in it. And it was a good team of everyone putting everything into it. And I think we will see more and more of it, but you got to have people at every different level. I mean, you know, seeing is believing and it becomes more normal. And honestly, back in the next America's Cup after that, I remember being in New Zealand and I was going to go take my law school exam and somebody had come to me and said, "Hey, you know, I hear that Oracle's talking about hiring you." And then when I followed up, it was like, "Oh, no, we're not." And then I followed up a little bit more. I was like, "Oh, well, your boyfriend's on one of the competing teams." I'm like, "Oh, right, because that matters." And then the next America's Cup, when Dawn and I were at the French, Oracle hired the boyfriend. So apparently it didn't matter that I was on another team. But, you know, who knows the truth of these matters? I mean, I never got it direct from them. So, you know.
No, whatever. In 1992, I was dating Barry Mackay. And he was with Team New Zealand, New Zealand Challenge at that time. And I was told in my contract, it wasn't in the contract, but while I was negotiating my very bad for me contract, because guys got paid double what I did, that I had to break up. And we've already established that I'm ruthless. So I was like, "Okay, no problem. I'm going sailing." And then eventually when they decided that that they trusted me, then I was able to start dating them again.
Yeah, I think having the women in leadership roles really does that, like cements it in people's heads. You look back at college sailing, and women coaching in college sailing was few and far, zero, and then few and far between. And now you have women running teams and being the head coach or the organizer of the entire team. And when I was in sailing in college, and when Melanie was sailing in college, like maybe there was one coach, you know, of all the teams. And I mean, look at the impact of that, right? College age kids that are saying like, oh, look, the boss of that team, who's a successful team, you know, they're top ranked. That's a female that's running that program. That's awesome. I could do that. You know, I'm an 18-year-old just getting into sailing. You know, I haven't been in the sport. I used to be a gymnast and, you know, somebody plucked me out of my classroom. I think seeing people in charge, you just get used to being like, yeah, that's not a weird thing. It's a totally normal thing.
It's interesting because right now, I think there is only one varsity female coach right now, which is Amanda Callahan. There are a couple assistant coaches that are female. So it's still certainly a long way to go. But I know, you know, the female in the leadership position is huge. And the number of female coaches has definitely increased and still needs to increase. I think that that's an area that will certainly help propel more women sailors. From the sort of race admin and the judge and running races, Melanie, do you see more women coming up that ladder from your where you are? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I think so. I fully agree with everything that's been said so far about more women need to be in the big leadership roles and then the trickle-down effect will happen. But during my time at St. Francis, when I was like working with the race officers and judges and stuff, it seemed like the amount of women were growing on that side of things.
What about SLGP? There's been some, there was some controversy on, you know, women sailing and not sailing on the boats. And
yeah, there aren't any women currently sailing on the boats. But there are a lot of women in the other team roles.
She works for SailGP. She can't say what I can say.
What do you have to say?
Oh, let me say, I've got something. It's important. And actually, Russell and I've had this conversation, and I thought he was, before all of the coronavirus and everything, he was leaning towards having either a requirement to have one person, one female, or to have an all women's team, or to do something. He was actually open to it. And it's any which way that we can get there. And the reason for it would be the same reason that right after the Women's America's Cup team, Mighty Mary, there were so many other women's teams, because it will help his bottom line. There is absolutely no question. And NASCAR knows this, other sports know this. You know, female coaches in football, I know some of them in baseball, they're there because they're very, very good. But they wouldn't get there unless it made financial sense, and they can, and the organizers can promote that. So with SailGP, if you had women on the boats and on the sailing teams, you're going to end up with more sponsor opportunities and certainly more fan opportunities. I mean, when I was walking around in New York, there was, you know, I was talking to people and they're like, oh, you sail? What, are there women out there? And I'd be like, nope. And they go, oh, and walk away. If I could have said, yes, there are, there's this person, all of a sudden it would have been this critical mass that, again, you can monetize.
Katie, Molly, any thoughts on that?
No, I mean, I think the numbers show that having women involved in women's teams and it is an economic boon. So yeah, I completely echo it.
Do you think, I mean, how can men help drive, you know, the visibility of women in sports? Because there's also a lot of talk about, you know, that women's sports receive significantly less coverage than the male sports on TV, for example. So how does that play into this whole idea of, you know, bringing more women on that would increase, you know, the sponsorship capabilities and the...
It's just a big circle. You know, you need the people, then you need to build the interest, and then you need to sell the tickets, and then you need to be able to pay equality. And so having somebody who's, and that's why I said any means impossible to get up there. So you know, as just a single individual sitting there trying to fight, you need to make decisions about yourself. When I was on the men's team in 92, I mentioned quickly, I was paid half of somebody who his paycheck got stuck in my envelope, exactly half. And when I went to management and said, well, this is bullshit, I'm on the A team, he's on the B team, I was told, well, he has a family and has to take care of his wife and children. And I had to make the decision that I had to let that go, because what was I going to say? Okay, I quit? No, I was going to do the America's Cup. So there's $30,000 that I invested in women in sailing by giving that up and not fighting for that. And then when I had the chance to be in power, we had equal pay as much as we possibly could. On America True, it happened. And the French team, I had one of the French guys come to me. And so this is what, 20 years later, and said, well, I need more money because I have a wife and five kids. And I had my line already. I said, just because you guys like making babies doesn't mean that you're more valuable to me. And he didn't know what to do except for to walk out the door. You know, so it's a long process is what I'm saying.
So I kind of feel like it's like you need, because it's not normal to have women, have it be gender equal in the big ticket teams, right? Mm-hmm. And you argue that, oh, but you know, look at the body weight of this person and they're gonna be stronger for that amount of size. And you hear all these little arguments, right? I think until it becomes completely normal that you're gonna pick a man or a woman simply on their ability, not because they're a man or a woman, you have to do this mandatory gender equity, right? Like the Olympics, or, you know, like the percentage rule in the America's Cup, or, you know, get as complicated as you want.
The ocean race.
What's that?
In the ocean race now.
Yeah. Right, in the ocean race, exactly. So like across the board in the big, you know, events that you're seeing on TV, there has to be, you know, there's a mandatory female spot percentage, whatever it is. And what's hard is you have to get past that feeling in society that, oh, there's the token female, or there's the token, you know, we have to have this person. So when it's hard, it's kind of like you're saying, God, it's like a circle, right? So you have to have that spot held. And there's going to be everybody in society that's thinking like, oh, it's just the token person who, you know, put their head down and just ignored everything. And they're probably not as good as the 50 other people that could have been in that spot. And you have to push past that and keep the mandatory spot there and keep it there until everybody has come up thinking that's a normal thing to have females around, you know, because you have the junior program directors that are females, you have the coaches at all the elite events that are females, you have the runner of the Olympic, US Olympic team be a female. It becomes normal that as you're going through the process of learning how to sail and getting into the sport and getting to the high level, females are there across the board. So you kind of have to start with this, oh gosh, you know, there's that token female, you know, stigma that kind of exists in society, and push through it and never let that go away. That mandatory, hey, I want it to be 50-50 because look at our population. So that eventually it becomes normal.
Well, hopefully by having women, you know, participating on the teams of the men are learning that the women can do the jobs, you know, that they are as good or better in many cases than the men. So that opens up, I think, also the men's, you know, mind frames, and you know, they go off and they talk to their, you know, their friends, hey, you know, she's the best trimmer I've ever had, or, you know, so that's also got to make some sort of a difference too.
Well, I'd like to jump in just for a second here. I want to just talk about how excited I am about how many great women sailors there are now. I mean, there are so many terrific people. When Ocean Respect Racing was put together in 2018, what was cool about it was a boat of kick-ass women sailors. The fact that it happened to all be women was actually a by and by. I mean, it was great that it was all women, but even when we were down there and we did really well, so many people who were excited it was a by and by. They were more excited about the sustainability message. They were more excited that a boat that was talking about clean ocean and what we need to do was winning. Well, we ended up getting second, but, you know, there were points. And that, you know, these are top women that I would sail with and would like to sail with again. And gosh, I would hate to be like, have somebody say to me, well, you know, you can only sail with half of them. You have to have half guys. And I know I could fill that half, guys, with amazing men that I sail with. But, you know, it's this idea that we want amazing female sailors, and in giving other female sailors the opportunity to stretch their wings and get there. Because every one of us who got on that boat at some point was given an opportunity and an opportunity to be new and to fail and to mess up and then try again. And I think that we're seeing so much more of that. And I know a lot of people that are watching this, especially guys, are like, but I don't have any issue with sailing women. I love sailing with women. So yeah, do more of it and give people who are new and young a chance, because they're going to fail and need a second chance like all of us did.
So, you know, what other, you know, a lot of people by doing small actions can make big changes. And, you know, you just mentioned one, Katie, about giving people opportunities. If you were, you know, each of you were to kind of give one person some advice out there, whether it's a young girl, you know, sailing, you know, optimists or lasers, or, you know, whether it's the woman who's learning how to sail later in life, or whether it's, you know, the father that has three girls, or the guy, you know, whoever it might be, what can those individuals do in their daily life to kind of help to promote women in sailing and in leadership positions?
I'll go first. The first thing is you ask yourself, am I making this decision or judgment because of a gender or racial bias inside? And outside, when you see a young girl or a young person, you say, of course you can. And you still at this point have to say it twice as loud and twice as many times for the girls, but we're gonna get there.
Melanie?
I would just have to say, stick with it and be open to any and all opportunities, because you can never know where they could lead or who you can meet, and hopefully the playing field levels up from there.
Katie, Molly?
Go, Molly.
What would you still say to a man, for example?
Well, my advice would be the same to boy or girl. I'd say get as many skills as you can, get as strong as you can, keep knocking on the doors, asking for the opportunity, showing up on the dock. Don't let people down, don't lie, and be tough and keep at it.
That was really well said, Katie. totally agree. That's like a good mantra for life right there. I would also say that you can't, me personally, everybody is different. You do have to get a thick skin, no matter what, you know, guy or girl, but you have to push forward. You have to put your head down and do the work. Do your job as best as you can, you know, and if your job is to solely learn how to sail and be sailing until you're 95, that's a job, and figure out how to be able to sail and have fun until you can't get on the boat anymore. If your job is, hey, I want to be a trimmer in America's Cup boat, then put your head down, do the work. Somebody's going to say something along the way that's going to rile you up, and it's going to, you know, shake you to your core and make you upset. You got to figure out how to like keep pushing forward, you know, and be able to ignore that, realize change is slow, and set a really good example. And like Don said, you know, be loud about, hey, this is awesome that this girl wants to do X, and I'm going to help her do it when they come to you.
I think it would, one of the things I've been thinking about is, you know, is what can, for example, you know, Russell, what could he do to help promote women in sail GP? You know, what could, when a woman comes in, has a great idea, you know, who's on a yacht club board, but, you know, she's with a group of men and they don't want to listen to her. What can the man do, you know, to help support the female in that role? I guess I was kind of looking for some other advice to that. If, you know, you were a guy and you're trying to help support women, what do you do? You know,
the same thing you do with the young guy that looks just like you, and you see yourself. I was like that. They need a hand. Just transfer that and look at a young female and try to help them. It's not that difficult. You know, we keep talking about it. It's like, just freaking treat people like people, like human beings, and do what you can to be equal. And I like the part, especially right now when we're talking about don't lie, be a good person. And that's one of the things we talk about at Oak Cliff. If we say we're building American leaders through sailing, we don't say we're building great American sailors. And that's a really important distinction.
Very important distinction. I don't know if we want to open it up now to questions from the audience. Brittany.
I'm like, I don't know how we do that.
Well, Brittany says that there are no questions right now from the audience, but lots of love is coming. So last chance for anybody that might want to email any questions for any of these ladies. And while we're waiting for that, we will, we're going to end it with any last comments from you guys. And then we have a short video clip I'd like to show.
No, thank you for everybody for tuning in. And there's always more sailing stories to be had, depending on the audience. So you can always reach out. Certainly EK, myself, Dawn, Molly, Melanie, we're always happy to come talk, talk sailing, talk leadership, talk skills building. You can reach us through US Sailing or various websites. Dawn's got a website, I've got a website. I don't know about YouTube. Molly's at CISA, you can find her. Melanie, I'm not sure how to find you, but you know, anyways, this is something we're all passionate about, clearly, and thanks for tuning in today.
Yeah, I would echo all those sentiments. And we have recently started a female coaching program in conjunction with US Sailing. So we had our first all-female coaching clinic this fall. I believe we'll do another one. There's some regional opportunities. So if you're interested in pursuing your coaching career as a woman, there's certainly more opportunities, because we talked about the fact that we want more women leaders in the sport and believe that that's one of the ways that we can do that, is to have more female coaches, and that'll have more female sailors. So please stay posted for that information as well. Anybody else have any last minutes talks?
We're having our first regatta this weekend, come hell or high water, with lots of safety. So we're hoping that things are going to get back to normal as long as we're all smart and safe and work together. So I'm looking forward to that.
Okay. Well, we're going to end on this video and thank everybody for tuning in. And let's see if I can share this screen a little bit better than I did last time. Here we go.
It truly was a quantum leap forward for women in sports. Before the women's team, women would always say, oh, I wish I could. And after, they were saying, I am doing.
Being part of the America's Cup changed my life. I went and sailed professionally for 11 years.
I have a daughter now, and she's 7. She thinks that sailors are women too. She doesn't know that there were ever boundaries of what she could do and what she couldn't do.
Everybody left there more competitive, they're stronger, they're more confident.
I'm very proud of the positive aspects that have come out of it. To me, it was a good investment.
So on that final video, which was some pretty spectacular comments from Dawn and Katie and Susie Leach. So we'll end there and thank everybody again for being here.
All right. Thanks. Come visit us in Oak Cliff when you're allowed to.
Thanks, everybody.
See ya. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks. Bye.